Music. You are now entering Parallel Universe.
And wipe your feet on the way in.
Mark Riley.
BBC Six Music.
Sung by Stung, but by Grace Jones. I'm Mark Riley, and over there on a little computer screen is our Bobby Hughes. Hello, mate.
Hello, mate. Hi. Yeah. Well, do you know what? I'll get straight into this because it is very pertinent. We look at the NME, 17th January 1981. Grace Jones has a new single issued by Ireland on February the 9th, specially written for her by Stung, called Demolition Man. Mm. Now, we're assured that it's not dedicated to Russell Harty, so people of a certain age will remember that she was on Russell Harty's TV chat show, and he turned his back on her, and she clocked him one. Well, several times, didn't she? And he kind of deserved it, really, because he turned his back on her in the studio.
He did, but I mean, I can't really remember it that well. It's a vague memory, but I mean, if you've got people in the studio and you've got to address them, do you not have to turn your back on somebody at some point in time?
Well, the thing about that, well, obviously they do chat shows differently now, don't they? Because you have the interviewer at one end, and then you have whoever, you know, two or three people, sort of all sort of in the same sort of view frame, if you like, so you can speak to everybody at once. Whereas then it was stupidly, really, you know, he was in the middle, and so one guest would be on his left, one guest would be on his right, so he'd have to turn his back to essentially ignore the person he'd just been talking to.
So essentially, she should have slapped the producer.
That's right, but I don't think the producer was in range. Well, but hey, I take your point. Anyway, so apparently written by Stung. Well, he was staying at Peter O'Toole's place in Ireland, I found out.
Right.
There's a great video for that as well, isn't it? Do you remember seeing that Grace Jones video for Demolition Man, where she's obviously she's got the shades on and the grey suit, and she's sort of marching in rhythm like a North Korean military parade, that kind of thing.
It's right, not
way ahead
it.
Of her time. All right. So, Enemies, January 1981, Gavin Martin reports here, Antmania has come in off the streets and stormed up the charts with a vengeance, with no less than four placings for Adam and the Ants on the singles, top 75, and two on the album charts. Not bad, considering the combo was considered a spent force this time last year. From the chart-topping album Kings of the Wild Frontier, both Ant Music and Dog Eat Dog, a hit 45s. Likewise, Young Parisians, first ever Ant single, astutely, has been re-released by Decca, and Do It Again, sorry, Do It Records have also reissued Car Trouble. It was not a strange one, but it was, you know, fortuitous in its way, because not long after this, as it alludes to here, you know, his band had left him, wasn't quite sure what he was going to do with himself. All of a sudden, he reinvents himself and becomes, you know, on his way to becoming the biggest star of 81.
Well, famously, yeah, McLaren nicked the band for Bow Wow Wow, didn't he?
Mm.
And
that's right.
The great thing was, I mean, all of those tunes that you mentioned there were great, but very different. So Dirk Wears White Socks was that kind of very great, almost angular, but really had a really great sheen to it, this punk record. And they were the favourites, you know, they were the pin-up band for a lot of the Crass and Poison Girls and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And then he tips up with Marco Peroni, who's obviously a pop genius. And they were both steeped in Bowie and T-Rex, I think, anyway, weren't they? And
that
they were like,
it.
At that point in time, they were like the new T-Rex, really, weren't they?
Yeah, definitely that. And that amazing kind of Burundi drum sound as well, which they kind of instigated, wasn't it? Like a few other bands as well, but they were sort of hit the mainstream with that. It says here, Young Parisians, originally released in 1979, might aptly be described as Adam's laughing gnome-type skeleton in the closet, with its weedy accordion stroll down the boulevard, coupled with pseudo-French intonations. It's more than the sort of thing one might expect from Peter Sarsted.
I actually like Young Parisians, but there you go.
Dirk Wears White Socks and Car Trouble, which provides the stepping stone between the old and new Ants, having been re-recorded with the newly acquired Marco Peroni, as you said, before they left Do It at the beginning of the year. Shouldn't be causing the Ant camp much embarrassment or doing the bank balance any harm. Goes on to say, when Thrills contacted the Do It offices, they admitted to having other Ant material in the can, but had no plans to release it. Likewise, those paragons of virtue at Polydor, who have on catalogue the very first Ant recordings, Deutsche Girls and Plastic Surgery, they say, not being an exploitative record company, the last thing we'd want to do is release an Adam and the Ant single in the present climate, said a press officer. Well, if I'm not wrong, Deutsche Girls got reissued, didn't it, about a year after this?
Again, a great tune, so fairly new.
Absolutely. Also in the news, the Stranglers, a protracted French court case saga, which began at their riot-torn Nice gig last spring, has since clouded all their plans and activities, is finally over. With the threat of prison sentences lifted in early December, their manager has now been informed the matter is deemed to be concluded. Drummer Jet Black has written a factual account of the whole proceedings to be published in book form next month under the title Much Ado About Nothing with a U. It's described as a cynical view of a ridiculous situation. This was kind of all over the music papers for a while, wasn't it? Because there was a gig. They did a gig, as I understand it, they did a gig at Nice University, and the sound, they had loads and loads of sound problems. It kept going off, and they became so frustrated that in the end, they just left the stage and said to the crowd, look, if you want your money back, then see the promoter. It's not our fault. And there was a riot ensued, and the Stranglers took the blame, didn't they?
Well, it seems quite a reasonable approach to me. I mean, but having said that, trouble did seem to follow the Stranglers around a bit, didn't it? And their relationship with journalists particularly was at least frosty.
Yeah, it was, definitely. Jet Black did say, Lacey said that really it worked in our favour because we laughed all the way to the bank. Before that, nobody had heard of us in France. Afterwards, we were playing to packed houses.
Right.
So notoriety pays.
Yep.
Enemy reports on page 4 on the New American Craze. season has sweep in the UK, Dungeons & Dragons says is rapidly becoming the thing to play in the States, now set to take off over here. A cross between the old-fashioned strategic war games and the more popular in the 50s and Lord of the Rings, it's a complex, unusual game with no board, no strict rules, and no way to win in the usual sense of the word. I probably know what your answer is going to be. Have you ever played it or seen it?
You do know what my answer is going to be. I haven't got a clue about it, mate. I know that people.
Me neither.
I know people are really, really mad on it, aren't they? I mean, it's
they are.
Yeah. I'm more of a Crash Bandicoot kind of fella myself.
It says here, is it going to be the new cult for the 1980s? And in many ways, it was. And of course, you know, in Stranger Things, people who've seen Stranger Things on Netflix, that was a thing, wasn't it? That bonded all the main characters together. They were playing D&D, and it's everything sprouted from there.
That's right. Yeah, I remember now.
Yeah, so my neighbour, I won't give out his name, but
give us his name and his credit card number. And
I don't want the paparazzi, Mark.
And his PIN number.
he drives over to Hull a couple of times a week to play D&D, and he's retired, so it's for all ages.
Right, okay. Does he dress up like him and go and fight other people in fields, and does he take it that far?
He just had his normal clothes on when I saw him, but I'll ask him. I'll knock on after this and ask him. Anyway, Information City, page 40. No, do you know what? Let's get on to this, shall we? Because the singles have been reviewed by Ian Penman. There's Rapture by Blondie. There's Ramones, I Want to Be Sedated. And XTC's Sergeant Rock.
Ooh, let's have it.
We'll be right back.
dedicate that to my mate Brendan Dillon. He'd rather have you too, but he ain't getting that on this programme. No offence, mate. That is XTC and Sergeant Rock, and I am Mark Riley, and that is your actual legend of Bob Hughes.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I know Brendan too. I wouldn't play you two for him either. No,
well, if he was in here now, I would play it. I'd do whatever he
definitely.
Said.
Yeah. Whatever he likes, really. Anyway, look at the NME here. 17th of January, 1981. Information City, Mike Gookie of Luton writes in. He says, I recently noticed that Nick Mason produced the second Damned album, Music for Pleasure. Is this the same Nick Mason that plays with Pink Floyd? If so, what other production work has he done outside of his Floyd activities? And Fred Della replies, yep, you're right. The Damned producer and Floyd person are one and the same. But further info about his production chores is unavailable, simply because nobody at Floyd HQ cares enough to answer my inquiries. I guess some people build walls rather than others, he says.
You know this, don't you? I think we might have discussed it on the psych thing. I'm not 100% sure, but they wanted Sid Barrett, didn't they?
I know, that was the thing.
They asked Sid Barrett, and they're like, no, you can't see you. Yeah, here's Nick Mason. So another member of Pink Floyd turns up. It's just a strange one.
Just that bizarre thing. They were absolutely dead set, as you say, dead set on Sid Barrett. And they just thought, we'll take anybody for the Floyd. They'll do, you know, that's how it worked out. On the centre pages and also on the cover, Paul Denoyer goes to meet Pete Fulwell at the Grapes on Matthew Street in Liverpool, across from what used to be Eric's, and it recently had been forced out of business in 81. He's got a new label. Of course, previously he was, along with Roger Eagle and Ken Testey, he was co-owner of Eric's itself, wasn't he?
That's right.
Pete Fulwell. So he's got a new label, Inevitable, home to Pete Wiley, who's currently engaged in what he calls a race against rockism. So, and he tries to explain himself. Pete Wiley, I mean, brilliant as a just for copy. You know, it's just a dream. You just set the tape recorder going, or what used to be a tape recorder, and he's off.
Yeah, he's just a force of nature. I mean, we've both met him, we've both had conversations with him over the years, and yeah, a brilliant character.
Remarkably. So some people in the past have found Pete Wiley a little hard to take. That's probably because they function at a speed of 33, whereas his words pour out at 45, while his mind goes round at something like 78. He shoots out ideas in an urgent and often confused torrent, laced with self-mockery and humour. It gets him misunderstood a lot, not least because of the thickness of his accent, but what you can't mistake is his commitment and his energy, his absolute dedication to Wah Heat, the group being only one facet in a wider, more dynamic concept. So far they've had two magnificent singles, Better Scream and 7 Minutes to Midnight. Present they're putting together the Wah LP, but don't say album. Pete regards the word as too rockist. So he's obviously on a bit of on one here at this point. He gets talking about, he says, we're not really about just enjoyment. We want to make something that people go out and do. Something having heard it in the first place, not just playing a band. That was the thing about punk. He'd say everybody go out and do something, so everybody immediately thought, well, that's a punk group, so we'll go out and be a punk band. Whereas, he says, there's loads of other things like writing or other creative pursuits. It might take years to find out exactly what's right for you, but you've got to start looking. It's not a passive thing, it should be an active thing. Find out what you're capable of. People say that rock is dead. Well, Bowie said it was a toothless old woman, and that's closer to the truth, he says.
Right, I do remember The Fall had a tune called Slates, which was on the that EP. But anyway, he said that Male Slates, he said, Wah Heat, the beat. And I know that Pete pulled him up about it and said, what are you slagging us up for? And he's going, no, I'm just a joke, mate. Just a joke. But at least Pete had the chops to front him up about it.
Yeah, absolutely. So he's also got just a bigger vision than merely making records and playing live, including Wah Radio. And also this, he says, we want to play live, but don't want to just play as Wah Heat and do an encore. We want to break that up, find new ways. We were talking before of almost doing a pantomime on stage, just finding other ways of doing it. I'd like some frogs on stage with us for some reason. Just have some crazy things going on. Performance art, even, to disorientate people, make them on edge, because when you're on edge, you're more receptive to things. So he does have a point there.
He didn't do it, though, did he?
No, he didn't.
With the frogs.
I wish he had.
Not that I heard of, anyway.
Yeah, I wish he had. Cynthia Rose gets to interview the B-52s. Late last winter, she said the B-52s appeared on Saturday Night Live in America, doing Rock Lobster and Dance This Mess Around. It was incredible luck, recalls frontman Fred Schneider. Just that one appearance changed everything. Suddenly, the B-52s were one of the biggest bands in America. And when they returned to Athens, Georgia, which is their birthplace as a band, Kate Pearson heard Planet Claire blasting out of a college fraternity house. She said, when we lived in Athens, she said, that place would have had bricks thrown at it. So suddenly the whole world's been like turned upside down. there were all these kind of sort of words thrown at them, weren't they? Like sort of very tacky and kitsch, camp, cultish, 60s derived, but they were just being themselves.
You know, I saw the clip of the Saturday Night Live.
It's brilliant.
It was on Twitter about a week ago, and I watched it. You know, you see all these things flying past you and think, yeah, that, yeah, yeah, whatever. And then I saw that and thought, I'm having a bit of that. And it really was so stripped back and brilliant. It was amazing.
Yeah, it was. It's fantastic. Kate says here, people are always hitting us with this American trash aesthetic thing, and we're not going to take it. We don't use that term, and the supposed trash that we're interested in is good trash. You can use it, try to make your life better by using rejected things, not just be surrounded by it and let it pull you down. She says, without being too pretentious, you can look at a Kmart shopping centre as a modern cultural museum and learn something from what's there and what that means. So there's way more to them than met the eye initially, wasn't there?
Yeah, definitely.
Gigs this week, you've got Dorothy Column at the Porter House in Nottingham, Depeche Mode at the Bridge House in Canning Town, Classics Nouveau and Richard Strange at the Lyceum in London, Roxy Music at Birmingham Odeon, The Specials and The Beat at Galway Leisureland, Level 42 at 06 in Southend, Black Sabbath, Hammersmith Odeon, Felt supporting Modern English at the Moonlight Club in West Hampstead, Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons at Doncaster Rotters, U2 supported by Altered Images at Manchester Polytechnic, strange bill.
Right, I saw U2 at Manchester Polytechnic with Waheed, funny enough.
Oh, really? Yeah. Right, okay. What were they like?
Pass.
Elvis Costello in the Attractions at Cardiff Top Rank, Gen X at Birmingham Cedar Ballroom. Aren't they going out now as Gen Sex? So it's Billy Idol and Tony James, Paul Cook and Steve Jones, isn't it?
Is it Billy Idol? That's weird. Okay,
because
I saw that because it's like, is it called Dog Day Afternoon and it's Iggy headlining it.
Yes, that's right.
And it has got, you see Gen Sex or Generation Sex, and you think, right, okay, that is them. But I thought they might have been doing that, and Billy Idol wasn't present. You would think if Billy Idol was present, they'd be able to call it Gen X, wouldn't you?
You'd think so, yeah, but obviously Sex Pistols, I don't know, it's a hybrid, I suppose.
Right.
And John Spencer's Spectacles at the Cock in Fulham. Wow, okay. Teasers, you got Steve Diggle, guitarist with Buzzcocks, was bitten by a bulldog while holidaying in Manchester, it says. Yeah, it really does say holidaying in Manchester here.
Hang on a minute. I mean, he lived here.
That's what I mean.
Well, okay.
Well, maybe, was he living in London then?
Maybe he pitched a tent in Piccadilly Gardens. I don't know. That'll be it.
Lost the use of his arm for 2 days, it says. At London Nightspot Cabaret Futura, the enemy's Paul Morley accidentally stepped on the foot of Richard Strange in what's believed to be a reference to certain reviews. Strange shouted out, "It's all right, Morley, you've been walking all over me for 3 years already."
Ooh.
And Andy Corrigan has left the Mekons, but he's doing sound for Racy at the moment.
Really, I didn't know that. Okay, we've got to go, haven't we, Bob?
We have, yes, Mark.
Thanks, everybody involved in the programme, and Gideon is next. We'll see you Monday night, Spencer Cullum live in session. We'll leave you now with Robert Wyatt, A Last Time Free. All right, cheers all, ta-ta, bye, Bob.
Bye, Mark.
come closer, my dear. It feels so good just having you.
Music.
And shut the door on your way out.